So welcome everyone to this 12th special lecture in the inaugural HAKI Vienna International Science School. It's my very great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Gerald Teschl, who is a colleague of mine. And through Gerald, I've made some of my first contacts to terrific Ukrainian mathematicians. He has a very close scientific ties to Kharkiv and has had them for a very long time, for over 15 years. Gerald is an outstanding mathematical physicist here at the University of Vienna. He is also an avid author, not only of scientific papers, but also of scientific books. Chances are that many of you, once you are at university, will use textbooks that Gerald has authored. They are really good, and usually plenty of hard and very well selected problems. So I love that. Gerald, the floor is yours.
Hey, so thanks, Michael, for the introduction. And of course, also thanks to the organizers for bringing these really nice lectures together. And also welcome to all the students. I have tried my best to find an interesting topic which doesn't require too much mathematics, so that you are at least too much basics, so that it is possible to understand at least most of my talk and to get at least the main ideas. And it's not really what I'm currently interested in and working on, but I always had a side interest on computers in general and computer science, and in particular also cryptography. And since I did the course recently, and since there is a lot of change going on, I decided to tell you a little bit about this. And maybe before I begin, I should also mention that I find it quite interesting to see that mathematics is getting a more and more important part of our life. Because in particular, for example, if you look into computer science, not too long ago, there was kind of the opinion that discrete mathematics is good enough for computer science. But now with artificial intelligence, this has drastically changed. And now you basically need all of math in order to do this. And what I also find quite satisfying, because if I watch my kids now, I see that they do their homework using ChatGPT. And of course, it's a big hype nowadays. But if you look at this a little bit more closely, then you will realize that it really can produce only answers others have given before. And it's not really creative in the sense that it can produce new answers. And so in particular, it will fail on the math homework most of the time. And this already shows that when you're doing mathematics, you have very good chance, or it's clear that you will not be replaced in the foreseeable future by a computer. So I think it's a very good idea to look at this field.
I thought the upshot of failing in mathematics using ChatGPT is then that somebody else has made the same mistake before.
That might also be true, but the point is, of course, it can't compute, right? I mean, if you ask it the product of two numbers, if the numbers are small, you will get the right answer. If the numbers are too big, you will not get the correct answer because the answer cannot be found somewhere in the database.
I will try this on my students, Gerhard.
Yeah.
Just tell me how large.
Anyway, let's don't get distracted too much. And let's look a little bit at cryptography. And you're probably aware, let's say at least you should be aware, that cryptography is really an extremely important cornerstone of the internet. And without public key cryptography, the internet would not work as it works today. Many, many things would not be possible, in particular e-commerce, and all these things would not be possible. And the world would be much, much different without this. And so let us look a little bit at this. So where I want to get at is kind of Lattice-based cryptography, which is top-notch nowadays. But I will start at the very beginning and try to set everything into context because I think it's not only important to understand what this is about mathematically, but also it's important to understand why it is important and what the problems are we are trying, or one is trying to solve with these methods. So I guess I should start with what is classical cryptography, which is also known as symmetric cryptography, because both participants, which are usually called Alice and Bob, they want to communicate with each other, and both of them have a shared secret, which is the secret key to an algorithm. And this secret key here is denoted by K. So typically this would be some number. And if Alice wants to transmit the message X, it just applies a mathematical function, which depends on the key, and then gets another, the encrypted message Y, which she transmits to Bob. And Bob also knows the shared secret key, and he can use a corresponding decryption function in order to get X back, okay? And all of that, of course, is pretty much straightforward, but it has one big drawback. And the drawback here is both Alice and Bob need to know the same shared key. So that means this key needs to be exchanged between these two parties before any encryption can be going on. While in some situation, this might be very easy, like if you think of a spy, when the spy leaves the office, then he just takes the key with him and then he can communicate with the office later on. But in a situation like the internet, where the internet is the only channel which you have for communication, and this only channel is insecure, it clearly cannot be used to share the secret, because anybody who can tap on the channel also gets the key and hence can decrypt any later communication. So this is a big problem. And in fact, this was a really big problem, because when the internet came up and big companies and banks were using encryption, exchanging the key was something which got extremely expensive. I mean, there were special firms transporting keys from one office to the other office and so on. And this was getting a nightmare. And so people started to think about whether it is possible to also share this key via an insecure channel, so that you don't need all this infrastructure for exchanging keys. Now, the idea would be the following. You no longer have one shared key, but you have two keys, E and D. And I see a little typo here on my slides. So this should be a D here. So you have two keys, and one is a public key, which is usually called E, because it's only necessary for encryption. Okay, so you encrypt your message, and I'm sorry, but too many errors here on my slides. So you encrypt the message, and for encrypting the message, you only need the public key E. If you want to decrypt the message, then you will need a second key, which is usually denoted by D, which is private and which needs to be kept private. So that means you take your public key, you put it on your homepage, wherever you want. Everybody who wants to send you a private message downloads this public key and then can encrypt messages, send it to you, and only you, who has the corresponding private key D, is able to decrypt the message. Okay, so that's the principal idea of public key cryptography. Now, if you think about this mathematically, you will immediately run into a trouble, because this is only possible if you know the inverse of the encryption function. So the decryption function must be the inverse function of the encryption function. So that means in theory, this is not possible. Because if you know how to do one direction, you can invert it, and then you also know how to do the other direction. So it looks like this idea doesn't fly, and it doesn't work out, and there is no way of doing it. But as always, there's a difference between theory and practice, and in practice, the whole thing will work. And this was the general idea of Diffie and Hellman, who said, well, in principle, it might be, it's always possible to invert a bijective function or to invert this function, but there might be situations where inverting the function is much harder than computing the function, okay? This is called a one-way function because one direction is easy and the other direction is complicated. And in particular, if inverting would just take too much time, even on the most powerful computer available, that means it's secure in practice, right? Because inversion, even if you have a supercomputer, even if you are the NSA, it will just take you longer, let's say like the age of the universe to get the result. And hence, even though you can do it in theory, you cannot do it in practice, okay? Because it's computationally infeasible. So the question is, where do you get such a one-way function from? And actually it took 2 more years until Rives, Chaiman, and Edelman provided the first idea, this famous RSA system, okay? So you probably have seen this already somewhere, and so I don't really want to dwell on this too much, but the idea is the following. So you take two numbers, two prime numbers, and you multiply them. And then it's easy to compute this product, even for very, very large numbers. And in practice, we're talking about numbers which will have, let's say, 1,000, 2,000 digits. Okay, so really, really large numbers. You will not be able to do this by hand, but even a weak computer, like a computer which will fit on a bank card, right? An ATM card, for example, on a little chip, will be able to perform such kind of computations sufficiently fast. On the other hand, if you just know the product and you want to get the two primes back, you need to factorize this number. And it turns out that this is something which is computationally extremely hard. And if the numbers are sufficiently fast, not even the NSA will be able to do it with all the money and all the computer power available to them. Now, the system works as follows, or the problem is solved as follows. You take two numbers, E and D, satisfying this relation here. So if you take the product and divide it by M, the remainder will be one, okay? So it's a multiple of M up to one. So it satisfies this relation here, and this number M is defined as P minus one times Q minus one. Okay, so not n, which is p times q, but p minus 1 times q minus 1. And now you can encrypt as follows. You raise x to the power of e, take the result again modulo n. So you divide by n and take the remainder. And decryption just works in the same way, but you don't use e, you use d. Okay. So now it can be proven that these two functions are indeed inverses of each other. I'm not going to prove this to you. It uses Fermat's little theorem. And if you know sufficiently much about these things, you can easily Google for RSA and proof, and you can check the corresponding proof. Okay, so for us, it's now interesting to understand a little bit better why this is secure. I also mentioned that if you want to break this system, you need to factorize the number n. Why do you need to factorize the number n? Because if you have E and you have n, which are the two numbers which are necessary for encryption, how do you compute d? You compute D by finding a solution to this equation here. And that means in order to set up this equation, you will need M, okay? And in order to get M, by definition, you need P and Q. So once you have this, you can set up this equation, you can solve it, and you get D. Again, I'm not going to tell you in detail how to solve this equation, but this is what is known as Euclid's algorithm. So there is an effective algorithm for finding the solution to this equation here once you have M, which you have once you have the factorization, okay? And I leave it as an exercise to you if you want to play a little bit. Show that if you know N and if you know M, suppose these numbers here, then you essentially also know the factorization. Okay, so these two problems are in some sense equivalent. If you can do one of them, you also can do the other one. Okay, so computing D given N and E in some sense is as hard as factorizing N. So you really need to factorize N in order to get this private key. If you can't factorize, you cannot get the private key. Okay, by the way, but I don't want to go into details again. This does not mean that there is no other way of inverting the function. Of course, once you have computed D, you have inverted the function, but there might be another way, but no such way is known at this point. So factorizing is the only known way of breaking this RSA system. And as long as factorizing is difficult, you cannot break RSA. Okay, so how do you factorize numbers? What you probably all have seen is the naive way, which is known as sieve of Eratosthenes. So the naive approach means you do trial division. Okay, so you take your number and you try to divide by all numbers between 1 and n. If you cannot find any divisor, then by definition, it's a prime number. Otherwise, you have found the corresponding factors. Of course, if you think about this a little bit, then you can make this slightly more effective by using two observations. The first observation is that if you have a product of two numbers, P and Q, then it's not possible that both numbers are larger than the square root of N, because then the product would be larger than N. So at least one factor must be smaller than the square root of N. So it's sufficient when you do your trial division to consider factors up to the integer part of the square root of N. So that's the first obvious improvement. Once you have reached this number, you can stop. There is no point in trying any further. And moreover, you can also save a lot of time if you do what is called sieving. Because, for example, if your number is not divisible by 2, it's also not going to be divisible by 4 and not by 6 and not by 8 and so on. So if it's not divisible by a number, it's also not going to be divisible by any multiple of that number. And this is what is called sieving, because that means you can cross out all the numbers which are multiples of what you have already tried. Okay? And that's an important idea, which is also used in more effective algorithms, because even though a division isn't much effort for a computer, if you do a lot of divisions, it takes a lot of time. And of course, you would like to save that time in order to get an efficient algorithm. So you need to do sieving in order to cross out divisions which are pointless because they are not going to work out. And as a simple exercise, if you haven't done this yet somewhere else, write a little computer program implementing this algorithm and try to factorize a number and play a little bit with this algorithm and see how the time increases with the number of digits, because what you're going to see is that the time will increase with the number of digits, in particular with the number of digits of the smallest prime factor in this number. And that means if you have a lot of digits, it's no longer going to be possible to factorize using this algorithm, because it's just going to be too many divisions and it's going to take even the fastest computer way too much time. Another idea, which is due to Fermat and which is very old, is the following. Suppose we can write our number as the difference of two squares. Okay, so we can write n as a squared minus b squared. So then you should remember, once you have this, of course, I can write as a squared minus b squared as a plus b times a minus b. So that means once I have achieved this, I have a factorization into two numbers. The remaining question is, of course, how do we get this decomposition as a difference of two squares? Well, the idea is the following. We just try. As a first try for A, we take the integer part of the square root of n. Okay. And then we're increasing this by one step by step until the corresponding b is integer. Okay. If you look at this formula here, then the corresponding b is just given by a squared minus n, and we take the square root. If this happens to be an integer, then we have found the required representation and we are done. Otherwise, we try the next one. If you try this again on a computer, it's very simple to implement, and I suggest that you do this. You will see that this works very well if the number has two factors which are close to each other. In particular, if you take two consecutive primes, then this is going to give you the factorization very fast. If the prime factors are sufficiently far apart, this again is not going to work and is going to take too much time. And as a fun fact, let me mention that obviously this is not known to all computer programmers, and this mistake of using RSA with two consecutive primes has been made by many companies. And even recently, so most recently in 2022, it turned out that Canon and Fuji Xerox in their printer software had made this mistake, so their communication could be easily cracked. Okay, so as I said, try to implement this, try to compare these two methods for different numbers, and in particular, see which one is better for certain numbers. Let me also mention one thing, but I can't go into details here. The most effective algorithm for numbers up to 120 digits, which is already more than what you could handle on a single computer, is based on these ideas here. So you need a small improvement of Fermat together with some smart sieving to rule out divisions which are not going to work out. Then you're getting this, what is called quadratic sieve, because of this quadratic representation right here. And this is a very effective algorithm. But here I'm just going to mention one more algorithm, because it's also interesting to see that very totally other ideas can be effective here. And it also connects with two of the other lectures you have seen so far. And this method is called Pollard's Rho method. And it works as follows. You look at a dynamical system, which you have seen before, which is just given by iteration. You take a starting value and then you apply a mapping to the starting value over and over again. So you apply it once, you apply it twice, and so on, which is called a discrete dynamical system, okay? And if you have a finite set of numbers like we have here, because we are computing everything modulo this number n, so eventually we will have what is called a collision, right? We have a finite set of numbers and we will get numbers after numbers, since they're only finitely many. Eventually, we will get a number which we have already seen before a second time. And this is called a collision. So that means the picture looks like I have drawn this here. You start with your starting value, you compute x1, you compute x2, and so on. And after some finite number of steps, you will get one of the values again. Let's say after 11 steps, you get the value x2 again, and then you have found this collision here. Okay. And if you look at my picture here, you might recognize the Greek letter rho, and this is where the name comes from. Okay, so how do you use this to factorize? Well, first of all, you need a function which you can iterate. It's not so important what function you use here. Many choices are possible. One choice would be this quadratic function, which you also have seen in the previous lecture. So you just square, you add a number. Again, it's not so important what number you add. Let's say you add 2, and then you take the result modulo n. So you just take the remainder by division with n. And then you ask, when do I get back? Well, here, since you want to find a factor, you don't require the solution to get back to the original, to one of your previous values. But you say the collision condition is that two values have a common multiple. Okay, so you compute the greatest common divisor of these numbers, and if you find a common divisor, then you have a factor, and then you're done. Okay, again, this can be easily implemented on a computer, and the question is, of course, why is it better than what you have seen before? And the reason is, I'm missing one thing here. The reason is probability. Namely, if you ask for the probability of getting an exact value, this might be very low. But if you just ask of the probability of a collision, so in a large set of points that two of them are equal, then the probability is much, much higher. And this is what is typically known as birthday paradox. So if you take, let's say we are how many, 30 students, right? If we would put all our birth dates into a Google document and then compare, the probability is quite high that two among us will have the same birthday. Whereas if I ask who has the same birthday as myself, so who has the same birthday as me, it's very unlikely that we will find someone in the audience. Okay, and this is this birthday paradox, which says that a collision is much, much more likely than a precise match. And for this reason, finding a collision is quite likely. And this is an effective method for factorization, which is much more effective, for example, than this sieve of Eratosthenes, even though, and that's also interesting, it's a random algorithm, because how long it takes to find a collision depends on the starting value, so it depends on luck. You might find it very fast, it might also take quite long, but on average, it will give you a good performance, okay? And it's also interesting that many algorithms are not deterministic. They will not necessarily give you a result in a certain number of steps, but there are many algorithms are random, but give you very good results with a very high probability. Okay, so I mentioned a few factorization algorithms. I could go on talking about methods of factorizing numbers for a whole semester. So you can give a whole course on these things. Some things are easy, some things are very deep in number theory and require very deep and difficult tools. But still, let's stop at this point and let's go back to cryptography. And I guess, or I hope you're convinced by now that factorization is a difficult problem. And even though people thought about this since many, many years, still it's a difficult problem. And even though one has made significant progress and has much, much better algorithms now, it's still not good enough for factorizing large numbers, which are used, for example, for RSA. Even though the number of digits you have to use in order to be on the safe side grows every year, because the computing power also grows every year. Anyway, the thing is, what I told you so far only is true for classical computers, okay? It's no longer true for quantum computers. Quantum computers can factorize numbers fast and efficiently. Again, I could talk for quite some time about this, so let me just spend a few words on this so that you at least have a rough idea. So what is a classical computer? A classical computer works with bits. So a bit means that you just have two possible values, 0 and 1, false and true, and you apply logical gates to these bits, and from this you can build everything which we have now, okay, with these very simple operations. A quantum computer is different because instead of bits, it uses so-called qubits. A qubit is a quantum mechanical system which can only take two distinct values. So in computers are in this context, this is usually called also 0 and 1, but it's just these two possible systems. That could be the spin of an electron, which could either go up or down, or it could be the polarization of a photon, anything like that. So as long as it only can take two possible states, it will be called a qubit. Now, the difference is that while a classical bit really can only attain these two values, a quantum bit, qubit, can also take any superposition. So you can take a linear combination of these two states, and it will be again a valid state. And there's a normalization condition. So the coefficients here, if you square them and add them, they need to add up to one. Okay, and the reason is because in quantum mechanics, these two numbers, alpha zero squared and alpha one squared, are interpreted as probabilities, namely the probability of the system being in the zero state and the probability of the system being in the other state. Okay, so these are probabilities, and that means a qubit can be anything in between in some case. And in this sense, it's of course much, much more powerful than a bit. And in this sense, a quantum computer is much more powerful, or could in principle be much more powerful than a classical computer. And I should also mention that if you now look at gates for a quantum computer, a gate for a quantum computer is just a linear transform which must necessarily preserve this normalization. Okay, that's an axiom of quantum mechanics, that all the changes you can make to the system must preserve this normalization. And mathematically speaking, that means you must have a unitary transform. So a quantum gate is nothing else than just a unitary transform. So in some sense, a unitary 2x2 matrix. So from a mathematical point of view, a quantum computer is something which is trivial, because we are talking about linear algebra in two variables, 2x2 matrices. Everything is very, very easy. But like in the classical case, which is even easier, you just have two values. When you combine many of them, you can perform very complex operations and can perform arbitrary complex calculations. Now, let me mention one more thing, because I think that's important to emphasize, because many people just think that a quantum computer is just a super fast computer which can do anything. This is not true, because a qubit has the classical bits as special cases. That means a quantum computer can do everything a classical computer can do. But classical computers have been optimized since these decades. That means classical computers, for these optimization reasons, are much, much faster than quantum computers and can handle much, much larger problems than quantum computers. And so from that point of view, a quantum computer can't provide any advantage. However, there are some algorithms which are only possible on a quantum computer, which can perform the same task with just a much, much smaller number of steps. Okay, so even though the quantum computer in principle is slower when doing one step, since it requires less steps, it might still be faster once one has a sufficiently powerful quantum computer. And in particular, there is one mathematical operation which is known as the Fourier transform. Maybe you have heard this somewhere, but it's extremely important in applications. You use it when you compress images in this JPEG, or when you listen to music on the internet. All of this uses the Fourier transform. And one of the mathematical properties of the Fourier transform is that it is a unitary operation. Okay. And that means for a quantum computer, this is kind of built in. So the quantum computer can perform the Fourier transform extremely effective, much more effective than a classical computer will ever be able to do. Okay. Now, the Fourier transform means, if you have heard this in your physics course, you take a signal and you decompose your signal into periodic frequencies. So in particular, if you compute the Fourier transform, you will see which periods are hiding in your signal. Okay, So that means when you can compute the Fourier transform, you can find the period of a signal. But when you have the period of a signal, you can factorize. And this is known as Miller's algorithm. Okay, so there's an algorithm which can factorize numbers once you are able to find the period of a certain sequence associated to that number. And combining these things, Fourier transform on a quantum computer together with Miller algorithm is known as Shor's algorithm for factorizing. Okay, so that means if you have a quantum computer which is sufficiently powerful, it will be able to factorize numbers, even large numbers like the ones which are used in cryptography nowadays. But of course, at this point, we do not have such powerful quantum computers. The ones available now, I don't know what the record is, but not too long ago, the record was factorizing 15 on a quantum computer. Okay. Now, of course, you can do better, but still you're quite far away from factorizing numbers which have 1,000 digits. On the other hand, maybe in 10 years, this might be possible. Of course, when this is possible, nobody can tell you, but it's a clear threat. And it's also clear that one needs to think about replacing current algorithms by new algorithms, which are not vulnerable to such quantum algorithms. In particular, if you look at how long it takes to replace a current cryptographic algorithm. So for example, I don't remember the numbers right now, but the classic, the standard symmetric algorithm was the data encryption standard. And I think it took 20 years or something like that to replace this by the advanced encryption standard. So you really have to be aware it takes years to replace an algorithm which is used all over the world. So you really need to start thinking about this. And in fact, this is something which has been done. And there is an institution in the US, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST, which asked the world for proposals for quantum-safe public key algorithms. So they said, okay, make your proposals, show it to the world. All experts in the world have a look at this and can check it for any flaws. And eventually, and that happened only recently this year, they kind of standardized the first algorithm which they recommend for practical use and which is considered safe against quantum computers. Okay, and there were many proposals, and the most promising ones are so-called lattice-based algorithms, and this is called lattice-based cryptography. And in particular, this algorithm Kyber, which is currently recommended by NIST. Also another algorithm, which is called Ntrue, which is approved as an ANSI standard. And also another algorithm, which is called Frodo, which is recommended by the German analog of the NIST, by the BSI, all fall within this category. And for this reason, I want to look a little bit at these ideas and show you what is behind all of this. So the first notion we naturally need is the notion of a lattice. So the idea is the following. Let us take two vectors in R2. I call them U1 and U2. And let's suppose they are not collinear, right? So they are not on one line, but they look into different direction. Then of course, they will span all of R2. That means that any point in R2 can be written as a linear combination of these two vectors. So you have kind of coefficients S1 and S2. And if you multiply U1 with S1 and U2 with S2, where S1 and S2 are real numbers, you can get any point. Now you get a lattice if you make a restriction and if you restrict these coefficients to integer values, okay? So you don't take arbitrary steps, you just take integer steps, and then you will just get these points here. Of course, I can show you the entire lattice. So this is just a little piece of the lattice, but you just need to think about this to extend infinite in all directions. Okay, so this is what is called mathematically a lattice. You take two linearly independent vectors and then you take integer linear combinations, and all the points you can get in this way are precisely your lattice points. Okay, so the first important thing to understand is that the same lattice can be spanned by different vectors. Okay, so the previous lattice is spanned by these vectors u1 and u2, as on the previous slide, but I can take another two vectors, v1 and v2, and they also span you the same lattice. Okay, so it's more or less obvious from the picture, but we can also verify this mathematically. The only thing I want to point out, not any choice of two vectors in the lattice will span the lattice. So for example, if I take twice u2 here, so if I take, let's say this vector, let's call this u3, then u1 and u3 will not span the same lattice, because I can go from here to here to here, so I miss every second point. Okay, so if I just take two vectors, it might not span the lattice, but in many cases, it will still span the same lattice. Okay, so important fact, which will play a role later on, is you can choose different bases for spanning the same lattice. Okay, my little exercise here is the following. I'm giving you two vectors, they span a certain lattice, and I give you another two vectors, and I'm claiming that they give you the same lattice. If you want to verify, what do you need to do is, you need to make sure that you can express v1 in terms of u1 and u2. So u1, well, let me... And you can do this with integer coefficients. Okay, so how can I get here? I can, of course, you need to write down a linear system of equations and solve this linear system of equations. But if you do it here, if you want to get v1, okay, I take u1 plus u2. This is not going to work, so I need to change my coefficients a little bit. Yeah, I really need to solve the system. So the system would be, let's call this, I call it S1 and S2. So we have S1 and S2 here. So that means that V1 is 3-1 is equal to S1 2 minus S1 here, plus for the second one, I have S2. And for the last one, I have plus 2 S2. So this is the linear system which you have to solve for S1 and S2. And of course, you can multiply this equation here by 2, and then you can solve for S2 and so on. So let me not do the computations. I should have prepared this before. Sorry for that. But you can easily do this as an exercise, solve this system, and then verify that you can express V1 as you in terms of U1 and U2, and you can also do the same for V2. And what you also need to check, you need to check the other direction. You need also to make sure that you can express U1 in terms of V1 and V2. Okay, so if both works, both ways work out, then you know that they span the same lattice. And yeah, and that's important to bear in mind later on. So now, what is the one-way function here? Or what is the difficult problem here? The difficult problem here, or one of the difficult problems here, is the so-called closed vector problem, which is usually abbreviated as CVP. So the thing is the following. suppose you have given your lattice and you have given a point x. And now you ask yourself, what is the closest lattice point? Okay, then that's the closed vector problem. So that looks like a very straightforward problem to solve. And in fact, it turns out to be straightforward in two dimensions, but you can do all we have done here with more than two vectors. So you are in higher dimensions, and then it's getting more and more complicated the more and more dimensions you have. Okay, so that looks easy at first, but turns out to be difficult for higher dimensional problems. And the important thing is not only for a classical computer, also for a quantum computer. Okay, so both of them cannot solve such a problem if the dimension is sufficiently high. Okay, so what is the, or what would be one naive way of solving this closest vector problem? The easiest way is called rounding. It's sometimes called Babbage rounding algorithm. So the idea is the following. We have a point in X in R2, and of course we can express it as a linear combination of our two basis vectors, like in this situation here. The only problem, of course, is that these two coefficients here will be real numbers, right? Because it will not be a lattice point in general. It will be a lattice point precisely if these are integers. But if I give you an arbitrary x, these will not be integers. So what's the naive idea of getting the closest one? Well, you get the closest number to an integer by just rounding, okay? So let us round this coefficient. So this means round. Take the closest integer and look at this point here. Now we have integers here, so it's a lattice point, and there are reasons to expect this to be the closest lattice point. So let's take a little example and see how this works. So in my example, I take these bases and these bases here. You should, that should be V. So two bases, and both of them span the same lattice. So I hope you trust me on this, but if you don't trust me, you just need to check this yourself. And let's take one point X, 5.2, 0.4, and I ask, what is the closest lattice point? And we try to solve this using our rounding algorithm, okay? So, first thing is, again, we need to express this here in terms of U1 and U2. And you can easily convince yourself if you take 2 and 1.2, then you will get your point X. So we round. For 2, there is nothing to do. It's the closest integer is 2. And for 1.2, the closest integer is 1. So we get the point 0.5 as a potential closest vector in the lattice. What if we take the second base here? Well, if we express as before x in terms of these bases, we get 0.4 the first vector plus 0.4 times the second vector. And if we round, then 0.4 gets rounded to 0. So the closest vector is 0 according to these bases. So why do we get different results? And in particular, which one is the better result? What went wrong here? Let me give you a picture explaining to you what went wrong here. So here's my first basis, and the red point is the point where I search the closest point. And obviously this is the closed lattice point, right? So visually it's clear what the solution is here. Now, if you round, the following happens. That means if I go one half in this direction, I get rounded to this point. If I go one half in this direction, I get rounded to this point here. So basically, that means everything which is within this gray square here is rounded to this point here. And of course, I can extend this. So these squares will tile the entire space. And everything within this square gets rounded to this point. And of course, everything within this square here gets rounded to this point. And hence, we get the correct solution in this case. So the first one is indeed the closest vector. Now, in the second example, the problem is that my basis vectors are not orthogonal like they are in the first case, but they have a very small angle here. And this small angle means that this domain, this rounding domain here, also gets very small, okay? Or it's very long. And now you see how I have constructed my example. I have just put this red point into this shaded region, but very close to this edge here. So that means that's a point which is very far away from this point, but still gets rounded to this point. And this explains why we get our wrong solution, okay? And that means in some sense, we can have a good basis, which is the left one, which gives you a good solution for the closed vector problem. And we also can have a bad basis. A good one is one which is close to being orthogonal, and a bad one which is far away from being orthogonal, right? Where the angles between the vectors are very small, and here where the angles are close to being 90 degrees. Okay. So we have good basis versus bad basis if we want to solve such a problem. And the question is, of course, okay, if I just have a bad basis and I cannot use it to solve the closest vector problem, how do I get a good basis? And this is known as lattice reduction. So you need a lattice reduction algorithm in order to turn a bad basis into a good one. Now, the standard way of getting an orthonormal basis is known as Gram-Schmidt procedure. Now, Gram-Schmidt works as follows. We have our two vectors here. So we have U1 and U2, and we want to replace them by a pair of orthogonal vectors. So the first one you take as is, and for the second one, you decompose U2 into two components. One which is parallel, which goes into the direction of U1, and another one which is orthogonal, right? And this is this Gram-Schmidt decomposition. So you use the scalar product in order to compute this piece here, which goes in this direction, and you subtract it from U2 such that you get an orthogonal decomposition. And then you have two vectors, U1 star and U2 star, which are orthogonal. Okay, so that's the Gram-Schmidt procedure. And if you know the Gram-Schmidt procedure, if you already have seen this, then you might notice that typically you will also normalize, because you do not only want to get orthogonal vectors, but you also want to have normalized vectors whose length are equal to one. But I'm not normalizing here because we won't need this. Okay, so this is why you don't see any normalization here. Now the problem is, this new basis here is not a basis for our lattice. Why? Because this coefficient here in general is not integer valued, okay? But it will only be a basis spanning the same lattice if this would be an integer. What do we do in order to refix this? As before, we're going to round, okay? So we take the closest integer to this real number here, and we do the following. Okay, so this coefficient, which appeared before, is not integer valued. So we round it to the closest integer, we subtract, and then we get a new basis for our lattice, which is not orthogonal in general, but it's better or closer to being orthogonal than what we have started with. Okay, so this definitely gives us an improved basis. Moreover, there is no reason to stop here, and we can repeat this procedure. We can exchange the roles of U1 and U2 and apply the procedure again. And we can do this as many times as we get an improvement. Okay, eventually you will no longer get an improvement and it will stop. But after finitely many steps, it will stop. And this is known as Lagrange algorithm, sometimes also Gauss algorithm. And in two dimensions, it will give you the best possible basis for your lattice, and you can use this to solve the closed vector problem. You will not always get the correct solution if your basis is not orthogonal, but even if you're off, you will not be off by much. Okay. And for all practical purposes, this will be a good way of solving the closed vector algorithm. Now, I mentioned in higher dimensions, everything gets much more difficult. You still can do this Lagrange algorithm, but you can only do it pairwise in some sense. And it's not possible to handle more than one vector at a step. And so it is not extremely slow, or it's still a rather fast algorithm if handled this way, but the results will not be good. If you want to get better results, you need to take more vectors into account at what time, but then you need to solve a complicated optimization problem. And then it just will take too long to handle any larger problems. You will only be able to handle very small problems. Okay, so the straightforward generalization is called Lenstra-Lenstra, or straightforward, is called Lenstra-Lenstra-Lovas algorithm, LLL algorithm. It runs fast, but the quality of the result will decrease with the dimension. So the more vectors, the worse the quality will be. Even though in many situations, the quality still will be good enough to handle many interesting mathematical problems, for cryptography, the quality will not be good enough of this algorithm, and you would need to do better, but this just takes you too much time. Okay, so I'm getting close to the end of my lecture. As the end, I want to explain to you how you can use this problem in order to do cryptography. And this goes under the name of learning with errors. And the idea is the following. So you look at the linear system of equations, like we have it like here. This will be a large system, not extremely large, but hundreds of equations. So not millions, but hundreds of equations. And again, we're looking at the situation where we only have integer coefficients. So everything will be integer values. Here, the coefficients, the solutions, and so on, all will be integers. Okay. And we're looking at the situation where typically you will have more equations than unknowns. So that means if you write down anything on the right-hand side, you typically will have no solution. But of course, you will always go the other way. You will prescribe the solution and then compute the right-hand side. So you will have a solution to this system. And in fact, even if you don't know the solution, if you just have the matrix or the coefficients A and these coefficients B here, it's still easy to compute the solution because this is just elimination. Gauss algorithm, Gauss elimination, which you learn in high school, can be used to solve this equation or this system right here. But now comes a tiny modification. You take this vector B here, these coefficients B here, and you add a little error term to each of them. Okay, so small perturbation. Of course, then X will be no longer a solution. In fact, there will be no integer solution to this system here, but you have an integer solution which almost solves the system up to this very small error here. And now the interesting thing, which is not so obvious, but it is like this, it's extremely difficult to find this integer solution. Why is it difficult? Because if you think about it, then you will realize that what you're having here is a lattice problem. Why is it a lattice problem? Because let's maybe look at this slide here. If I look at the column vectors here, so if I look at these columns here, and if I say these are the basis of a lattice, then these numbers x1, x2, and so on would be the corresponding coefficients, and the resulting b would be the lattice vector. If I perturb this a little bit, that means that I have a non-lattice vector, and what I'm looking at is at the corresponding solution, which gives me the closest lattice vector. Okay, so that means solving this system approximately such that I have a very small error is the same as solving the corresponding closed vector problem for the lattice spanned by the column vectors of this matrix here. And I already told you that this is a very difficult problem computationally, so it cannot be solved effectively. Okay, so this is a lattice problem which is sitting here, and now you're using this in order to transmit a message or to set up a public key system as following, and this idea is due to Regev. And it goes as follows. So first you choose some parameters, of course, the number of equations M and the number of columns N. So these two numbers here. And you also choose a number P. It might be prime, but it doesn't have to be a prime number. And all computations are taking modulo P. So you always divide by P and then you take the remainder. And of course, if you have two numbers which are equal modulo P, you can take a representative. So typically the representative is chosen to be between 0 and p minus 1, but here it's chosen to be between p over 2 and p over 2. Okay, so we're kind of taking everything symmetric and we're looking at negative and positive parts here. Now the key generation is as follows. You take your matrix A, your coefficients of your linear system, randomly, choose them as you like them, and then you construct the solution. So you choose your x, you choose your solution again randomly, multiply a by x, you get a b, and you add a little perturbation. Okay, so that means x is not the solution for b, but for b minus e. So up to a small error, it will solve this system right here. Now e and b are your public key. These are needed for encryption, and the solution X here is your private key. Okay? So as before, if you want to break this system, if you want to compute X, you need to solve the corresponding lattice problem. And I have mentioned this is hard, so this is infeasible if the system is sufficiently large. Now, how do you transmit a single bit? The idea is as follows. You have given your bit, and now you choose a random number, okay? So a vector of random numbers. And this is used to mask your bit. So first of all, your bit is multiplied by p over 2. If this is not an integer, you round off to have an integer. So you get an integer which either is equal to 0 or it is equal to p over 2. So either it's very small or it is large in our context right here. And then we add the scalar product between this vector b and our random vector r. So this is a random number which typically will be large and which will mask this bit here. So because of this randomness, v will give you no information about x, because the random, this scalar product could be either large or it could be slow, low, who knows? It's not possible to get any information about this bit x here if you just know v. So in particular, if you just transmit v, it will not be possible to decrypt with this information. There must be a way for Bob to remove this mask here, okay? And hence, you also transmit R. But of course, you cannot transmit R directly, because if you transmit R directly, then even the eavesdropper can remove this mask. So you don't remove, you don't transmit R, but you multiply R with this matrix A, more precisely with the transpose of the matrix so that everything works out. But you take these linear combinations and you transmit these two quantities as your encoded message. And now the problem is, if an eavesdropper gets these two pieces of information, V alone doesn't help. You need to remove this mask. For removing this mask, what you will need is, you will need a solution of the system before, okay? Bob has this solution X, so he can remove the mask up to the small error. But since we round our solution, the small error will disappear by rounding. And so you get your original bit back. And this is the idea of using cryptography, of using this lattice-based cryptography. And two more small remarks. One remark, of course, is, as it looks, it's very ineffective because you want to transfer one bit and you need one large vector of numbers, of large numbers, and another large number. So you really need to transmit a lot of information just to transfer one bit. So in order to make this whole thing efficient, you need to do a lot of tweaking. And first of all, you can use the same matrix for many bits and so on. So, but let's not go into details here. One can make this more effective, and then it really gets usable in the internet. And in some sense, the main idea here, it can be used like this, and this is what Frodo does. And another way of getting things more effective is that instead of making your computations modulo a number, which is the integers modulo numbers are a ring, mathematically speaking, if you have heard this, you can replace this ring by something more complicated like a polynomial ring. And this is what is done in Kyber. But the ideas are the same, and Frodo doesn't use a polynomial ring. So for this reason, it's called, or for this reason, this algorithm is called Frodo. If you know the Lord of the Rings, if you know this story, Frodo doesn't want the ring and throws it away. This is why this algorithm is called Frodo. Okay, but I guess that's all I wanted to say, and I have used up my time. So thanks for your attention. I hope that you're still awake and did not fall asleep. But yeah, anyway, thanks for your attention. And if you have any questions, I will be happy to answer them.
Hey, thanks so much, Gerald, for this introduction to cryptography. Just checking this algorithm that you've shown us, this Frodo algorithm, that is one that is quantum computer safe.
Yeah, because the thing is, there are no quantum algorithms for solving the closest vector problem.
Mm-hmm. Very cool. Questions from the audience. Gerald, I think you've written a textbook already on cryptography. Is that possible?
Yes, I wrote some lecture notes, but the problem is that the lecture notes are in German.
You know, there's such a thing as auto-translate. Maybe we can advertise them.
yeah, we can discuss and maybe make this available to the participants, of course. Uh-huh. But you have to be very careful with automatically translating mathematical texts, because in many cases the result is more for amusement than really useful. But yeah, sometimes it also works.
So what got you interested in cryptography, Gerald?
Yeah, as I mentioned, I mean, in some sense, I came to mathematics because of, let's say originally, I was interested in computers as a youngster. I was interested in computers, and originally I wanted to study computer science, but at that time, that was not possible for me. And so I studied physics because I also was interested in how computers are working internally. And so for me, that was kind of the closest I could get. I didn't know at that time that I should have studied mathematics, but eventually I realized that experimental physics is not my thing. And after that, I realized that maybe theoretical physics is also not my thing. And so I kind of drifted off to mathematics. But I always have been interested in computers and computer science. And cryptography is an important aspect there, and understanding these kind of things, and also understanding how people fail using cryptography is something I enjoy to read. So I always follow the news in these topics, and it's fun to understand why certain things can be broken and how they can be broken. So for me, as a cryptography, it's not so much about the algorithms itself, but it's about why is it hard to break them? How could you break them? So how do you factorize numbers? How do you compute this discrete log problem? That's something I didn't talk about, but it's also a big issue. And I think this is very beautiful mathematics, which is involved there. And I always enjoyed this, even though it's far away from what I'm doing research-wise.
Have you met Peter Shor?
No, I just have seen some talks online. That's the advantage nowadays with YouTube. You can hear him even though you haven't met him yet, but he seems to be a very nice and gentle guy.
He is. So he's a professor at MIT.
I know.
I know him from. I haven't watched any movies of him, but he's pleasant and very fun.
Yeah. What is maybe also interesting, if you look at these whole things, you see that people are playing with things which are at the point when they are playing with them are more or less totally useless, right? This starts with this RSA cryptography. I mean, this is number theory, right? I mean, computations modulo, small Fermat, Euler theorem, and so on. When these guys did this in the 16th, 17th century, all of this was totally useless and nobody ever thought about using these kind of things. And now it drives the whole internet. And also when people like Feynman were proposing this concept of a quantum computer, it was not clear whether it would ever be possible to realize something like this, right? And also when Peter Shor designed his algorithm, it was not clear whether there would ever be a quantum computer available, able to running these kind of algorithms. So from a student perspective, this kind of shows that it's worth looking at things which look totally useless at the point when you look at them. And it's really curiosity which drives this world, because without curiosity, we would be nowhere. If we would only look at the problems which seem interesting at this point, all the big advances would never been possible.
Awesome. So if there are no more questions from the audience, or no questions from the audience, I guess it's time to call it a special lecture. Thank you very much again, Gerald, for your talk.
Thanks for the invitation.
And to the students, thank you very much for attending the Hacky Vienna International Science School. I hope you've enjoyed the lectures. I'm also thinking about maybe extending this online series. I would be very interested in your opinion of what has worked well and what we could do better in the future. So this is an attractive channel for you to watch. So if you have any ideas or opinions on this matter, please email Mito and we will get back to you. Maybe we can have a small task force of thinking about how we can continue this even better into the future. So until then, maybe also my very great thanks to Mito. So he is the mastermind behind this program, even though he's always keeping quiet. So thank you very much, Mito. So I've enjoyed working with you on this very much.
Michael, thank you very much for your excellent moderation.
That is top on my list of things to improve, Mito, but thank you. okay, bye, your students, and I You know, I hope that I will one day meet all of you in Vienna. I've said it before, Vienna is my favorite city of them all. If you see a chance to visit, please do. You're always welcome here.
Yeah, I came there a few years, 8 years back. I loved it. I came to Vienna, yeah. I did a road trip from Rome to Vienna.
Please, Ashi, did you say you've been here before or you are planning to come?
Yeah, hello, can you? Yeah, I'm saying, I've been to Vienna like 8 years back.
Oh, okay. So then I hope you are up for another visit.
Definitely, I loved it.
I've been to Vienna too.
Yes.
This summer, I've been to Vienna.
Yeah.
I liked it.
Well, I'm glad you guys agree. Ah, Vienna is awesome. And so are you. So thank you. Bye, you guys.